notated music, whatever you want to call it. But I think at the same time, it's easy to talk about, if I can find it. No. Let's go back. Maybe. Yes. Okay, here we have a picture of steel drummers from Trinidad. One of the most interesting things, I think, when you think about the Industrial Revolution, broadening the human, all these different things. The Americans left, thousands and thousands of 50-gallon oil drums in Trinidad after World War II. And people started playing music with them to the point where the oil drum tops bent down. People started creating pitches out of this, creating the steel drum, basically just out of drunk. So you can think about the John Cage kind of like high modernists, we're going to push beyond the means of 12-tone music and pitches to new, you know, realms, whatever. And then you can think about like, hey, we found some stuff on the beach and let's play music with it. Two very different approaches, kind of similar endpoints, I guess.
Where was I going with this?
After that, you start to think about, let's talk about influences a little bit. I grew up in the 80s, a little bit into the 90s, and a big thing were industrial bands. And you start thinking about popular music bands that started using found percussion. This is Test Apartment from England, well known for using giant plastic like barrels. Yeah. We all know, hopefully we all know this guy, F.M. Einheit, also known as Mufti from Einstürzenbauten Neubauten. Neubauten, of course, a German industrial band from the 1970s, mostly well known for creating a ruckus, trying to take down overpasses in Berlin, and basically trying to destroy every venue that they played at. You start to see people using these giant coil springs and things like that. There's a bunch of different inspirations and ideas behind all of these people. Let's see what else I have. Somewhere in here there's a Kevin Key, maybe? Ah! Kevin Key, Skinny Puppy. I believe this is a tour for Two Bar Park, but it doesn't really matter. Notice the huge 50-gallon oil drum on his drum kit. Somebody that used a bunch of different stuff and was actually influenced by Test Apartment as well. A couple other things. Let's see, what else do we have? This is a lesser-known band from San Francisco from the 90s called Shark Bait that used all metal percussion and guitars that I always thought was really interesting. No, too far. Aha. This is Roscoe Mitchell's very beautiful put together sort of found percussion setup that he's used over the years, both in the Art Ensemble Chicago and in solo pieces as well. So you see different people coming from different backgrounds using different ideas from this.
I think I have one more picture. Let's see, what do we got? Ah!
Sorry to talk about found percussion without talking about Sleepy Time Gorilla Museum. Mm-hmm. This was the only picture I could find of Dan's acetylene tank cap marimba. I think that's Carla in the background. I literally stole this from Mo's Facebook page. Sorry, Mom. Appreciate you. I love this instrument. Found it really interesting. Hung out with him a few times when they were on tour, and I thought one of the funniest comments was, well, we should take off after the gig because we need to find a junkyard in Tucson to fix whatever instrument that broke that night. Literally, Dan said this. So, thinking about like how to deal with these instruments and stuff. A lot of what I do is found percussion, modifying found percussion, and then also the family business is sewer contracting. So I have access to a drill press and a grinder, a couple different things, wheel saw. I know not everybody has that, so I wanted to talk about easy accessibility of some of these things. And I started to think about the three easiest places to find percussion are the kitchen, the garage, and probably the junkyard. So let's talk about each of these. The kitchen. I have, that's not good, I have a bunch of metal bowls. Metal bowls are made and super easy to use. Right, upside down. Also played with a mallet or a stick. You can imagine 6 or 7 of these put together, played with mallets, played with things like that. Pretty much any container you can use, putting different foods in those containers to create shakers, all sorts of things like that. What else do I have? Oh, look at this. This is some sort of tea-making device, which could be used as a shaker or as a implement to make sound. So that's pretty easy, right? The kitchen. The garage is probably even more interesting and more easily accessible. Here's 3 things I found in my garage this morning before I left for work. A wrench. A ice grip. Oh yeah. And a ribbon maker. Yeah, this one's probably the least interesting of the whole thing, right? And also, a dustpan. I just bought this because my youngest child destroyed my old dustpan. This is my, I've been working on my dustpan techniques. Anyways, you can imagine the possibilities are endless. You also start to think about how do you create sound? How do you play these things? And obviously forks and knives are super easy. I'm a huge fan of the chopstick. I've got here, I've got orange plastic chopsticks. None of these were stolen from a restaurant, by the way. I have the metal Korean chopsticks, which are wonderful by themselves. And, ooh, I did actually pay for these. These are laminated chopsticks. So you could imagine whatever the instrument is. Using these different things. Clearly, as you get into the garage, the idea of threaded rod, these different things like that, are all totally usable and accessible. Let's see here. Since we're talking about kitchen utensils and things like that, I'd like to point out, if I can find it, the wonderful ESP Eastside Percussion. This is a New York percussion trio, Jim Puglies, Christina Bard, and Michael Evans, who recently passed away. One of the coolest recordings I have in terms of percussion instruments. Almost all found instruments using different sounds to create these things. And all small sounds, too. I mean, they're not dragging around a bunch of brake drums and things like that. They're all smaller sounds, obviously found in all these kinds of situations. Okay, so we did the kitchen, we did the garage. Now what about the junkyard? Junkyard's cool. Brake drums, obviously. For me, this comes back to Trinidad too, because Trinidad uses brake drums a lot. This is a smaller brake drum. Brake drums are extremely loud. Let's see what I have here. Yeah. There was a point where I was actually hauling around about 8 of these in the back of my truck and using them for gigs. It was a dumb idea. You guys should all start doing that so I don't have to. Most people play them this way. You can play the top and using a stick or a mallet. You can also put them upside down. They kind of turn into a like the mixing bowl. It's very diffuse, maybe not as interesting as a thing. Another easy access in junkyards is hubcaps. At this point, finding metal hubcaps is just about impossible. So if you do find them, grab them. I recently found a Cadillac hubcap at a Goodwill for like $10. It's probably cheaper than that. This is, I don't know what this is. Hubcaps work great as sort of a fake gong. And notice that I've attached some strings here. I've been super influenced by Danny Frankel, who's a percussionist, played with everybody, Katie Lang, Lou Reed, Kamikaze Ground Crew. And he has a bunch of different hubcaps that have strings with strings attached. And you can imagine with some chopstick, this turns interesting. Etc., etc., etc. I mean, scraping and all sorts of different ideas. A lot of people do the strings across the other side as well. That's a nice, easy thing. This one seemed to work better where I used bolts to raise the strings up off the face of the hubcap. By the way, if anybody has questions, let me know, because it feels weird standing here for an hour talking. Okay, where are we? Skip. I was talking about John Cage, I was talking about modern music. It's impossible to talk about percussion instruments and building your own instruments without talking about this guy, Harry Perch, microtonal composer, instrument builder, crazy man. Made some of the most interesting the music of the 20th century and some of the most interesting instruments. A lot of instruments were built around his tuning systems. He came up with this 43 notes to an octave system. And also, just use a lot of scrap percussion, found percussion. I have, where's that picture? Oh yeah, so here we have the cone gongs. These are actually from the cone's planes. For a while he had a workshop in Sausalito, I believe. Anyways, it was right next to the military yards, and he was picking up scrap metal. So a lot of his instruments are built around these ideas of using just excess stuff from junkyards. He also built giant marimbas and all these different things. I have a couple instruments that I've built that have been sort of influenced by him. Okay, if we keep going with this, two other things that are easily accessible and I find really interesting. Number one, let's find the picture. No, no, maybe, no. Yes, I passed it. Thunder sheets. Thunder sheets are just simple, really thin pieces of aluminum. You can find them at whatever hardware store you like. They can be mounted. You can just grab them. I did not bring one because they're super heavy and a pain in the butt all around. Every time I use one, I cut my hand. So, but they are pretty easy to use if you're into that kind of sound. You see a lot of people hanging them from racks and different things like that. Easily used. Played with hands, mallets, kicking, shaking, whatever it is. Another easy would be rebar. Rebar, as you know, is just steel. This is a triangle. Jerry Davis, who's a welder, built this for me 20 years ago. It's just a piece of rebar we bent, turned into a triangle. Clearly, this is not going to pass the test to play Tchaikovsky on. But it has its own interesting things because it's got these sort of ridges on it. You can create there's all sorts of options here. I would love if you guys, I know I have sort of things that I've come up with, but I know you guys have immediately going like, well, that'd be cool if you did it, but like made it like six-sided, or take these things farther. Tell me what you come up with. I'd love to hear that. One more rebar thing. I built these wind chimes over here. They're kind of hard to see in the dark. This is four pieces of rebar. And I used a tuba mouthpiece as the middle piece, and the top, I think, is from a power outlet. nice and easy. You start to get into bar theory, talking about nodal points. You can get really far with that kind of stuff. But those are some easy ways, simple things that you can pick up, hardware stores, junkyard, things like that. Do we have any questions at this point?
Can you explain a little more about bar theory?
What's that?
The bar theory.
Oh, sure. Okay, so generally when you talk about percussion, you start getting into the idea that there are bars, right?
Mm-hmm.
Xylophone, glockenspiel, marimba, vibraphone, whatever. And when you're using anything like that, you basically have a bar. And at some point somebody said, we should suspend this so it rings longer, right? Because if it's just sitting on something, it's going to go doink, but if you actually lift it up. And people realize that there are certain points where the vibrations allow the bar to ring longer. These are called nodal points. Similar to strings, right?
Mm-hmm.
Strings have different ways to break things up. Touch it in half, right? You get these different harmonic series. So different bars, different bar shapes. You can get super deep into this. A marimba, for instance, has the bar, and then they actually cut underneath it, not quite a half circle, but just like a little bit of a moon shape.
Yeah.
Same thing with a xylophone. The xylophone's cut a little bit differently, and that's how all of these are tuned. So if you actually go, you can grab a marimba bar and grab it at different points. So for example, what do I have? Show you how to. But basically, the simplest way to do it is you have any object, and you basically just shimmy your finger down, hitting it, and you'll find a spot where, oh, it rings longer, because you're not getting in the way of the vibrations. So, and people, you can look these up in books where people have different mathematic equations to figure this out. You can also just kind of shimmy your finger around and figure it out. It depends on like how far you, like clearly if you're making marimbas, and you want them to sound amazing, you're going to like go super deep into this. If you're putting pieces of rebar on a wind chime to put out in your backyard, you probably just want to find something where it sounds nice. Same thing with pieces of pipe. I've made instruments out of pieces of pipe for some reason. I don't think that made it here. But you can do similar things. Yeah. Same thing. I've created instruments using just graduated rod, using smaller pieces of brass that I've cut. And each time you're just finding, like, what's the best way to mount this? Is it hanging it? Is it putting it on something where it can sit? Is it just putting it on a piece of carpet or something like that? I guess that's sort of up to things. I remember Roger Turner, the British drummer, came to town, and like in like every percussionist, right, he's got a little bag and he's got stuff in the bag. And we were talking about, like, because he's, you know, he's got a couple towels, he's putting stuff on drums. And he's like, yeah, well, you can't tour, you know, with stuff hanging on frames. You got to put all that stuff in a tiny little bag that can make it on a plane. And I thought, yeah, I never thought about it like that. Because I was building these frames, you know, and hauling the stuff, and I've got this car, and it's packed full of junk, and like, yeah, this is great. I don't know how I'm going to get to Seattle, but this is, it all looks great. So you start thinking about that stuff, and a lot of people are just like, put a towel on the drum, place these things on it, they make sound. It's not going to be as amazing if I built this perfect stand for it where it's perfectly vibrating in the right spot. So these are things to think about.
I have a question.
Yes.
For your chimes, did you have specific pitches that you were going for? Because they're different lengths. Right?
For this?
Yeah.
No. It depends on the instrument. Most of the time, I'm not really too interested in exact pitches, especially if I'm just making wind chimes. I mean, I have some wind chimes that I bought where the people actually measured these pipes and
yeah.
tuned them to G and things like that. But I'm just more interested in the overtones and the sound. Like, that sounds super interesting to me, rather versus like a normal pipe.
Yeah.
You know,
it's like a bell sound anyway.
Yeah, exactly. Same thing with a lot of these things. We're going maybe a little out of order, but I built these. These were sort of inspired. Harry Parch built this thing called a boo, which is bamboo, and he cut it and created tongues. It's a little dark, so it's hard to see. Point towards the camera. So it's actually created a tongue. It's a pipe. So clearly the tongue is sounding. Right? It sounds totally different than if you had a pipe. And clearly, again, like we were talking about, do you mount this on like a piece of foam? Do you actually like drill it and mount it over strings or something? These I've actually been working on tuning, right? The idea of grinding underneath or grinding right at the mouth to create different pitches. I have. I also don't know how to mount them, so I've been figuring that out too. This is just like a work in progress. I happen to have some pipe. I have this giant wheel saw at my disposal, which is.
You got cobwebs in there.
Oh yeah, totes. Don't tell Matt. So this is just like, yeah, let's see what we can do. Got the pipe, got this giant wheel saw, which allows me to cut in a couple different ways that you wouldn't be able to, right? So that was sort of the idea with that, and then I haven't really been able to take it as far as I want, but I'd like to build like another 20 of them too. That would be interesting. The same thing happened. I had these larger aluminum bars, and I thought, I'm gonna make the lower octave of a marimba. Sorry, vibraphone, right? Vibraphone goes down to F, low middle C. I'm gonna make a whole octave below that. It'll be rad. So I got these bars and I cut them, and I was like, yeah, now I gotta build a frame. And I started thinking about it. I'm like, this is absolutely insane. How am I gonna do this? Let alone how am I gonna tune it and do all these things. So you start to think about these things. Like I said, I used to carry around brake drums. I built these large pipings, and there's one that's about this big. And it has probably 25 pipes on it. And it's 60, 70 pounds to carry around. I put a handle. I actually used it for a while without a handle on it, which was the dumbest thing. And then I decided to build two smaller ones, put handles on those, and I carried those around a while. Sometimes some of the stuff is just too much. You start to realize, like, maybe just having a little bag with a few things can be useful. Harry Parch, I think, taught us that build the instruments, but also when you build the instruments, you have to start the ensemble and write the music. And you start to think about, like, okay, how far do I want to take this? Am I going to, like, build six of these, write 10 years of work around it, get this toured and all these things, you know? Or am I just, like, you know, making rebar triangles? Okay, let's keep going. How are we doing? Okay, we're doing great for time. Let's talk about, ooh, I missed a couple things. Real quick. Some other interesting kitchen type stuff. Flour sifter. Awesome. Make sure you go get one. This one was $1. This, I think, is an incense holder. Perfect.
Do you get all these at Goodwill?
Yeah, or anywhere. Yard sale, secondhand stores. Yeah, my wife hates me. I'm always tapping on things. Also, if you're going to a junkyard, don't bring drumsticks. They will flip out. Yes? Nobody will. What, you gonna hit everything in the junkyard? Yes, I am, sir. Is that all right?
Get the hell out of here.
Believe me. I mean, if you like being vibed by old guys at junkyards, you should do that. But try and get a little bit more, like, yeah. Nobody gets the idea that, like, I want to buy 20 of these hubcaps. Yes, I'm making an instrument out of it. You're like, it's gonna be bad. Okay, let's talk about cymbals. Cymbals. Metal instruments. No, I'm going the wrong way. So a lot of what I do, fixing cymbals, repurposing cymbals, broken cymbals. Cymbals are probably the instrument that break the most, if you think about it. Maybe guitar strings, but at some point every cymbal breaks. So most cymbals will break. Rafter was here a couple months ago. This is a Rafter symbol. So you can see it's cracked. And most of the time, the cracks happen at the edge. You can see somebody kept playing it and kept breaking it after it broke. Occasionally, you have radial cracks, which go along. And I think I have, let's see if I can find. find a picture. Aha. So a couple easy ways. You just saw the picture where I've chopped the little chunks out. That's an easy way to fix symbols. Here's one right here. This is James Zizek's Wuhan. He's never picked it up for me after I fixed it. James, can get your symbol. Easy cut. I use a pneumatic angle grinder. Not everybody has access to this stuff. I understand that. Easy ways to do this, you can use a Dremel. I had a buddy who was using tin snips, which are literally basically scissors to cut these things. Some of that works with these smaller symbols. Notice this symbol is thin enough, you can bend it. That's not gonna work for some of the thicker symbols. But there's plenty of things. There's a couple different symbols I've cut out both from the inside and the outside because of various cracks. And these are all to be recreated in the instance. This is another James Zizek symbol who he didn't pick up, but he wanted me to cut it to a weird way. So that's what this is. I take it back, that's not James' symbols, that's mine. There's a bunch of people doing this now, it's very popular, everybody's got a drill and maybe a grinder or something. You can definitely tell the people that are good at it. I have Andrew Green in Chicago does a bunch of this stuff. He's amazing. And he uses he even told me, I gotta look it up. Oh, a Fordham cutter, which is basically like a heavy duty jeweler cutter, right? He obviously is doing these things much more intricate than some of my heavy handed stuff. One of the interesting symbols, Dave King from Bad Plus, has this old Zen symbol. Let me show you a picture. No, that's the fixed one. Where's the symbol? Okay, there's the bell.
It's thrashed.
Honestly, if somebody brought me this symbol, I would be like, sorry man, it's gone. Do you want to cut it up and make timbal chains out of it? Because that's what I do. Andrew actually took the time to make this come back to life, which is amazing, and he does amazing work. So check out the...
Wow.
So you put a rivet in the middle, and then he's using these smaller screws to connect these. And he's given the symbol a couple more years of life. Dave's still using the symbol to this day. Pretty amazing. So if you have something very delicate, send it to Andrew. He's going to totally fix it. Most of the stuff I do ends up being cut into smaller pieces. We saw this picture. These are all symbols that had cracks enough that I decided to just completely cut out a larger circle and make a smaller symbol. So this happens a lot.
I have a question.
Yes.
Those rings that you cut out, do you do anything with that?
Oh yeah.
Hey,
Mom.
What do you do with that?
Personally, it depends. I've done stuff where I put it on top of another symbol.
Oh, like a stack?
Yeah.
Oh.
I've actually riveted it onto another symbol so it stays.
Oh,
yeah. You can just use them as a multi-purpose, free-flowing, put this anywhere. I've done it where I put tambourine jingles on them. Put them on top of a drum. You see that? That's very popular.
Yeah,
people are doing
that,
now.
Yeah.
Even some of the larger symbol companies are doing these things where they're taking these kind of rings. This one is a little bit smaller and a little bit lighter. So it just depends on what you want to do with it. I've had people, a lot of what happens is people hit me up and say, hey, I have 7 cracked symbols. What should I do with them? So we can turn it into, here's a couple. Oh yeah, there's that splash. This was, I can't remember who this was. Anyways, they had a couple broken symbols. We ended up taking the splash and cutting it up and then using the pieces and riveting to the Zildjian Z right here on the right.
Mm-hmm.
So, and then I put some tambourine jingles on the other symbol, and I cut some of the cracks out of the other ones. It really just depends. There's kind of limitless options. These are all symbols that have been made from larger symbols that broke. And they just turn into bell symbols. This is an old Zildjian. This is maybe a Paiste. Couple things that I like to do with these, you can cut them into different shapes. Okay, here's a segment symbol. I got really into this. My buddy Sal Galagos gave me like 15 broken ride symbols because he's a madman. Mm-hmm. And so I cut a bunch of them down. I made some hi-hats for him. And then this is this is a very thick, you can see it doesn't even move. I think this was an A custom ride. So I cut out, had multiple cracks, and I cut it out. And then I thought, it's so heavy, you're not going to be able to use it as a crash cymbal. Not going to be able to use it as a hi-hat cymbal. It could be cool as sort of a bell cymbal. But what if I cut these segments into it, and you get this kind of sound? Not that kind of sound. This kind of sound. Right. It's not quite in the go-go bell, you know, but it's kind of similar. It's like the cymbal version of the go-go where you have these different pitches. But they all resonate, right? If you hit one, you can see all the other ones are resonating as well. You get all sorts of interesting sounds. So that's one option that I've done a bit with thicker cymbals. Clearly, with these rings, since we're here and we're talking, shout out to Gino Rivera. This is one of the most interesting percussionists in the United States, well, in the world, actually. Found percussionist, uses a drum kit, uses modified cymbals, uses found sounds, all sorts of things, and has been doing it for decades. We're getting ahead of ourselves. Let's talk about safety. Okay, when you're cutting up anything, wear gloves. Gloves. Wear something over your eyes and hopefully your entire face. Face mask is good. Eye protection is good. Ear protection is very good too. Do not wear sandals. Make sure you have good shoes on. Make sure you don't have anything, any sort of clothing that's going to be able to get caught in anything. In general, be super careful. I have somehow managed to not harm myself in any way using all sorts of things. I do say, I'm not a religious man, but I do say a little prayer before I use the wheel saw because that is the most dangerous thing I've ever dealt with. All of these things you end up with. See here.
Space.
Oh yeah, here we go. Okay, so you were saying about the rings, right?
Mm-hmm.
I usually end up cutting the rings into smaller chunks.
Mm-hmm.
Here's something from some, and then here's some other pieces. Yeah. And I realize these kind of make interesting sound. And so I started. So I'm making these chains. These are nice. And these are all just small little chunks from broken cymbals. Usually I use one cymbal to make a chain, so it's all the same sound. Sometimes matching two different contrasting sounds is kind of interesting. And pretty much always, multiple chains is more interesting. This is like a... This is an Avanti, which is a German cymbal, really heavy cymbal. Yeah. Notice how completely different they sound. What else do I have? This is one of the one of those light China cymbals. You get kind of a wind chime texture, these kind of sounds. These are super useful. probably my best seller. Okay, what else are we doing? I was just talking about. Oh, yeah. Right there. We're talking about bolting things to instruments. Clearly, rivets have been used for years, right? Starting out with jazz drummers drilling holes and putting little screws. Go back to Zeddy Singleton or, excuse me, all sorts of different people who are doing that. You've seen recently people are doing tambourine jingles, different things. Clearly the picture I showed you, I was actually riveting on pieces of other cymbals. This is a cymbal I made that's all tambourine jingles, but the idea is the jingles are actually right at the edge, so it cuts down on the resonance, and you get almost like a gated sound. People know what an audio gate is, right? The sound shuts off, so you get very, very short sound. This one, I actually, this is an old junker that my brother gave me. You can see it used to have tape on it, and it's got 18, 20 tambourine jingles. I realized too many tambourine jingles. So I made one with half the amount of jingles and a little bit lighter cymbal, and I got a better. I like this cymbal, but it's also like it doesn't get used very much because it's sort of an experiment. Let me check my notes. How we doing?
Yeah,
I'm
kind of curious.
Cymbals? Yes.
Can we hear how the bell sounds on that cymbal?
The bell on the cymbal?
Mm-hmm.
Sure. Oh, just this? Yeah, yeah. I wish I had a real stick. Okay, there's sticks in that other room. Oh, there's a stick right there. All I have is chopsticks for some reason. You can imagine. All right, guys, I'm ready for the gig. All I brought is little bell tree things and chopsticks. You can imagine if you're, like, a lot of people clearly are trying to recreate electronic music, gated cymbals, modified cymbals, these kind of things where people are cutting up in DAWs and stuff. And you hear a lot of people doing stuff like that, where they're creating these different sounds. This one, like I said, I think it's too dry. I have one that's, this is an 18, and I have one that's a 16 that's a little bit lighter and has half as many tambourine jingles, and I find that to be a little bit more useful. But this is kind of interesting. Right, it kind of creates its own world. Okay, another. Cut myself on this. Okay. Everybody's super into these cymbals these days because that one famous guy started using them. But this is a spiral cymbal. I made this in 92. This is the first cymbal I ever cut. It was a cymbal that had a chunk cut out of it that I found. I was in high school. The first person I saw with a cymbal like this was the guy from the Rippingtons. The Rippingtons were a smooth jazz band from the 80s. And the percussionist had one of these. And we had, for some reason, somebody taped it on VHS. I used to watch this concert. Anyways, and I was like, what is that? That's amazing. And I found this cymbal and I was like, oh yeah, I could go to the sewer contracting yard. And somehow I didn't kill myself because it was like the first time using a grind. You can imagine, like, you're like 16. You're just like, I'm just going to grind this cymbal up. Anyways, so these are pretty cool because you can get this sort of. This thing is sort of hitting against the thing. But you get this sort of almost Doppler effect and these different things. I've made a bunch of these small ones, big ones. You see people using them a lot more recently. How are we doing for time? Oh my God. Okay. We're getting close. Any questions? Thoughts? Concerns?
I have a question.
Yes.
What would you say is your ratio of completed instruments to, like, stored junk?
Oh. I
well, no, I didn't mean it like that.
really try and make sure. I didn't start this, like, I do this a lot, and I definitely didn't think, like, I'm going to start a business. I'm going to fix symbols for stuff. I was just, like I said, I found this symbol, and then I had a couple broken symbols. My friend Marcos Fernandez had a trunk full of broken Pisces from the 80s when he was in this new wave band. And he said, you should take these. And I went and talked to the welder that worked at the family business, and I was like, don't we have a, how do you cut this stuff down? And he showed me, like, how to use the lathe and stuff, and we cut a couple of them down. This, I don't even know where it went. But anyways, one of those symbols, one of the first symbols that got cut. So I sort of just turned into this thing, and I was doing it kind of for myself, and just making stuff, and wrecking symbols. I ended up, I don't even use the lathe that much anymore, because I wrecked too many symbols. Because if you're going too hard and you're trying to cut that, like we were talking about cutting the rings out, I was doing that on lathe early on, and those symbols just pop off and chop your toe off, and you got too much. So now I'm just using angle grinder and then cleaning it off. But I try and make sure that everything gets used, and it got to the point where I have all this stuff and I start trying to sell stuff.
Mm.
Because I made so many symbol chains that I was like, I need to get rid of these.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't have enough room for all of them. There's still a few I try, I should say this, but the more interesting ones I keep. Because
mm-hmm.
I like them,
mm-hmm.
right? And those are the ones that I end up using. There are certain things that I cannot sell. For example, these. These are larger chunks of symbols. And I was going to make them into a symbol chain, but I thought, these are kind of cool. What if you just, if you put them on a drum and hit them, they're kind of like gamelan. They have this interesting sound, super interesting. I cannot, I've never been able to sell. I have like 5 of these in different sets. I use them on recordings. Never gotten anybody into like the idea of selling these. No, wait, I take that back. Charlie Chavez bought some for me. Thank you, Charlie, you're the man. But in general, I try and get everything out the door. There is a fair amount of like research and development stuff. Like, for example, this ridiculous symbol. Okay, so this was a symbol, another one of Sal's symbols that had so much damage on both sides that I was like, well, you kind of look at a symbol and you're like, well, what can I do with it? Do we have any more pictures that we haven't looked at? We saw that. We saw that. We saw those. Like these. These are nice crashes. Just cut them out. Somebody can use them for rehearsal symbols, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're going to crack them again. It's going to happen. I don't need to cut them up, right? They're still usable. They still make good sounds. Some of these symbols are so gone that the Raptor symbol, I don't even know what to do with that symbol. It's so far gone. I can cut it up into little chunks and make something out of it. But so for this symbol, excuse me, I thought maybe I'll just try and cut it in a different shape than usual. So I ended up just cutting off both sides. I did, because it's so heavy, it almost turns into like a gong. And I ended up lathing hand. I grinded down the bell a little bit, and I did some machine lathing, and then some just sort of fake, real minimal, trying to bring the mass down a little bit. I end up using this all the time because it's so interesting. And it actually has, because I did a little bit of grinding on one side of it and not on the other, there's a little bit of pitch difference. So some of these things just end up on my records. I don't see anybody buying one of these for me. And also, I've had people hit me up and just be like, hey, I just don't like this symbol. Do you want to cut it up? And I'm like, no, sell it. There's nothing wrong with it. There's no cracks. No. No, I'm not going to. Why would I do that? It's perfectly usable. Use it. Find another symbol you like. We don't need to destroy it. So I'm trying to stick to just repurposing things that are not usable.
Okay, any more questions? I think we're pretty
Yes.
much out of time. Yes.
You mentioned that triangle is rebar. I'm not sure what rebar is.
Rebar is just a thick metal that they use for construction. When you drive on the freeway, they use rebar to support concrete.
Okay.
Right? You've seen it a million different times. People use very long pieces of rebar for construction. So it's just a thicker piece of metal. There's like three things I didn't play. The segment idea I've also used for flat pieces of metal. For example, this one. This is just a piece of metal that I happened upon that sounded really good, and I thought it'd be even better if I cut it into segments, right? And maybe that's all the instruments I brought.
I have a question.
Yes.
Do you have a full song recorded with these instruments?
I have different things. I've used them. I sort of have a history of playing solo drums, not drum solo, but like solo percussion, and they're kind of throughout all of those recordings.
Mm-hmm.
And then I use them in different groups. It's an interesting question. Like some of the stuff, is it usable in like a, if you have a jazz band, are you going to use like, you know, all these wacky cymbals? Sometimes, yeah. The cymbal chains are totally usable. I found pretty much in any context or some point where you're going to want like a nice little kind of almost wind chime sound, those are totally usable. And then different things happen in different situations.
Mm-hmm.
I have an hour-long recording of wind chimes that I haven't put out because I figure nobody's going to listen to it. like for this and the segment symbol, there's a duo recording of me and Vinnie Golia, and that gets used all over that. There's the new trio CD that just came out with Dan Klukas and Kyle Modell has a few different things. I have a few large mortar shells from like Korean War.
Mm-hmm.
You buy like, you know, military supplies places. Those are definitely on that. I'd have to think about it. Yeah, there's all sorts of different things and different stuff. Most of this gets used on my records, and then I will sneak it into other people's records if they let me.
I have a quick question.
Yes.
Do you think it's very feasible for most people to craft some form of like homemade string instrument, or just because once pitch is involved and mathematics are involved, does that
yes.
make it prohibitive?
Most definitely. I would say across the board, like, this is just stuff I've created, and I guarantee all of you, like I said this earlier, all of you can come up with cooler stuff than I've come up with. And here's the little alleyway I took. Rebar? Oh, what do we do with that? You know, you just, yeah, totally. There's people making weird zithers and all sorts of stuff, and making long, you know, you've got everybody, like, from making these little string instruments to... Lucier and Alan Foreman and those people with the giant string instruments where they're like running their fingers along the strings, right? There's a million different options of where you can go. Each of these different things, you know, you could easily, like there's Anna Homler or somebody who has like tables and tables of flower sifters and all these interesting little small sounds that she uses when she makes her music. So yes, take any little part of this and run with it, please. I'd love to hear what you come up with. Yes.
Have you made non-percussion instruments?
I guess I should say, notice almost all this is metal, and I do work with wood, and I've used gourds and all sorts of other stuff. A lot of this stuff is a little bit, I think, more accessible, because I don't think everybody has access to a wood shop, so I kind of focused on a lot of the found percussion and stuff like that. There was a point where I was really into strings, and I built this weird, I called it a harpophone. It was basically like a large metal frame with industrial wire and guitar tuners.
Hmm.
And it went like this, from the tension.
Mm-hmm.
It was a failure.
And
I took
it
apart.
What did it sound like?
It sounded like a giant out of tune harp. It sounded really good through three flangers. And then I was super into the long string instrument idea for a long time, and I was trying to figure out ways to like run like 20, 30 feet worth of industrial wire across wherever I was living.
But it's not as feasible as you think it is for some reason. And so that kind of failed. Like if I had an industrial space, I would definitely have like wires running, you know, like 60 feet across and some sort of pickups. I've definitely made, I made a few industrial wind harps. A wind harp is just a set of strings usually on some sort of resonant body put in the window, and the wind blows across the strings and makes them. They also make large giant ones. You've seen them in Norway and things like that. Put them next to the fjord.
When you've done strings, have you experimented with other tuning systems?
No. I'm not really interested in different tuning systems. I'm a percussionist. I use Western tuning systems. I use different overtones. I'm happy to use like tonal systems, atonal systems, all of those things. Like Harry Partridge is a huge influence in terms of instrument building. The microtonal thing is not why I got into this. For me, it's more about texture and tone and things like that. People get really like, oh, you know, like you've seen people go really far in the microtonal thing, and that hasn't really ever interested me. I like to listen to it. Like I'll put on Glen Branca or something and be like, yes. But for me, I'm definitely not gonna like start, you know, writing for retuned guitars or whatever. Yes.
When you're making these, do you ever take into account like, I don't know, specific like measurements or lengths or anything, or did you just go by instinct and like what you just said?
Yes, more and more recently, definitely. Especially cutting down cymbals. Where's that? No, we went too far. So when I'm cutting down these cymbals like that, it used to just be like, how much cymbal can I get out when I cut the chunk out to still have as much cymbal possible. And then more recently I've been like, okay, I can get a 12-inch cymbal out of this, because a lot of these, especially when you're cutting these cymbals down, they often end up being hi-hats, and you're going to want to match it up with another cymbal.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm definitely thinking about size for some of them. And then some of the other ones, if somebody asks me to cut something into a weird shape or I'm doing something random, that's not so much of a concern. And then the small bell cymbal is the same thing. Sometimes you just want to get as much metal as you can out of it. And then other times, you have to take into account. Yeah?
I have a question.
Yes.
You said that you only cut up cymbals if they're like damaged.
Yeah.
But like how damaged do they have to be? Like if there's like keyholing, like would you cut it up?
No.
No, okay.
I mean, no.
Okay.
I mean, it's a cymbal. Is it still usable? I've had a Clay Hackett, a metal drummer here in town. He's a drummer here in town. He hit me up. He said, I've got all these broken Pisces. And they all had like little cracks in it. And I just said, great. Cut his things out. Cymbal sounded great. Gave another 5 years on it. It was perfect. Like, I'm not going to destroy those cymbals. I've had friends hit me up and said, oh, I have this $400 crash cymbal. And I just don't like it. Let's lay it down. Like, no, just sell it. Go find one you like. Why would you want to? Yeah.
Have you ever welded or reconstructed broken cymbals?
Okay, welding does not work. Soldering does not work. Pretty much nothing works. No. And I am not a welder. I have people I know that can weld for me occasionally. But no, it doesn't work. Unfortunately.
Is it like the welding or soldering material isn't like vibratory enough?
I'm not sure. I mean, what I do have actually is that I can show you because it's in my car. I have a box of all the really, really fine, super sharp, dangerous little stuff that gets, you know, on the ground after you cut this stuff up. And at some point, I'm going to melt all of those down and create something interesting. But that's completely out of my skill set. Yes.
Do you happen to know what kind of metal cymbals are typically made out of?
Yes, they're either B8 or B20. It's a combination of copper and tin, and then sometimes there's some different combinations of things.
Cool.
And people talk about the old, like the K's from Turkey, or the K's Elgins. They were just throwing tin cans and whatever. You know, they talk about that's why it's so interesting. Everybody's got their different formula in terms of how much their combinations are, and they're like well-guarded secrets. Supposedly there's only like three people at the Zildjian company that know the actual I'm not, I didn't say this at the beginning, I'm not a symbol maker. I repurpose symbols. There's plenty of people out there that are buying blanks, they're lathing symbols, they're hammering symbols. I do a little bit of hammering, I do a little bit of lathing. I can do that, but it's always in the service of repurposing. Yeah?
No, that's awesome.
Okay.
So Nathan, at this point, normally we move into the lobby and have some refreshments.
Yes.
Continue the Q&A.
I need some popcorn because I haven't eaten today. Thank you all. Let me know if you have any questions.